Hey everybody, this is Rydo, and we're back to Lego Pirates of the Caribbean. I want to call it Lego Indiana Jones, but nope, that would have been a different game I played a long time ago. Alright, so we're into the third movie. We did Chapter 1 Singapore, not really ever being told much of the actual story of the movie, so I'm very confused as to how we started in Singapore. Particularly since this seems like this is happening just days after the events of the second movie, in which they would have probably been much closer to the Caribbean, fighting the Kraken and seeing that Jack Sparrow was killed by the Kraken. Now we're going to Davy Jones' locker, chapter two, so just across the world completely. Basically starting in Singapore just so that Disney can try to appeal to the Chinese market. This would have been right about the time when the Mulan movies came out also, and there's nothing wrong with the Mulan movies, in my opinion, for I haven't really watched them. But they definitely were trying to appeal to the Chinese market and didn't really succeed. If anything, I think part of the problem with Disney's attempt to appeal to the Chinese market and Hollywood's attempt to appeal to the Chinese market very often is that instead of doing what Hollywood and Western movie developers have been good at, which is making like Western movies, they're changing themselves, and thus whatever they're compromising their art, which is not a good idea. So here we see a whole bunch of Jack Sparrow clones, which I don't know if I ever figured out if they were actually different parts of Jack Sparrow's minds or just tormentors, and there's only one true Jack Sparrow, and he is on the other side of the world. It's weird that the camera is stopping and yet the studs seem to give you, and there's just an invisible wall that despawns you and spawns you back, which is interesting. It's just so it's like total sea salt, sand, beach, and the foreground has got all these beach elements. So I don't know if this is supposed to be a representation of an afterlife or just a magical special place. How he ends up here after being eaten by the Krakens, I don't think really explained. So yeah, just weirdness in general, and how the ship went with him. Like, this is where you would want to kind of get back to the idea that the Black Pearl itself was magical, and thus, with the Black Pearl being damaged, that's how he ended up in this location off the edge of the world. And there is something very interesting to the idea, certainly, of this being a world in which you can fall off the edge of the world, compared to the real world, where which is a globe. Most of the maps that would have depicted the edges of the world like that, though, also would have. Let me make sure all the extras are turned on. We may not have the fast forging enabled. Yeah, we don't. We probably won't even use it, but better to have it on than not. Yeah, most of the maps I've seen have four mythical creatures in those kinds of environments, in the edges of maps. If the idea is that you would fall off the edge of the world, so you would expect then for a four movie series that there would have been at least four sea mythical creatures. A dragon, a kraken, a giant squid. It would make a lot of sense, certainly, to have your story take place in Singapore at one point if to bring back Jack Sparrow at this point they had to defeat those four mythical creatures, and then in Singapore was the dragon, since dragons are of great cultural significance in Asian cultures. And then, like, England, Britain would probably be like a giant lion if there was a avatar type character that represented each land. Those very wobbly tree leaves as it lands. We want to get as much studs as possible. We want to play the game as much as possible. Although, since I think this game is going to be shorter than most LEGO games by about half, we may very quickly have all the studs needed, all the treasure needed, and there may not be a good reason to, in free play mode, break a bunch of things and try and get a bunch of studs. And even now, it may be less worth it. We have different starting points to look for things, but I don't know if the different starting points are actually actual indicators of where you have to start. Like, it might not be just a terrible idea just to do something like this and just start here. Like, because all it's gonna do is point you towards the other starting point. And if we take this rubber ducky and we give it to this Jack Sparrow, this really is just an excuse for the video game to unlock another version of Jack Sparrow. There we go. This guy has a shovel with him. That was just a collectible. So this one has a gun. But only the first one has the compass. Interesting. We've now knocked this guy down and he's looking for what looks like the inside of a peanut. But red for some reason, and he has the explosive bomb. So, yeah, this one's called Imaginary Jack Sparrow. This one's called Imaginary Jack Sparrow. So there is only one true Jack Sparrow. And it's the first one. Knowing some of the drama, not knowing all of the drama, but knowing some of the drama around the actor who played Jack Sparrow and Disney and just people not really wanting to work with him, I wonder if, for one reason or another, without really having to speculate, they didn't really want to act with this guy so much, and that's why you have this whole sequence where he is completely left on his own. But you could also chuck that up to just ego, because in the second movie there was a whole bunch of like visual action sequences that two were not really what's the right word do you say here? There's a whole bunch of action sequences that built up Jack Sparrow as a character. And if they were really just trying to kill him off, then it would have been fairly easy to do it in either the production, pre-production, or even post-production of this movie, since he had been shown effectively killed in the previous one. This is hardly the first time, also, we've seen an actor threaten to be killed off, or actually be killed off, for public demand to bring them back, or internal demand to bring them back. There's quite often a far too adversarial role that happens in the production of making movies, where you would think everybody should be on the exact same page and working together to make the best product possible, but the egos are huge, not just with actors and celebrities, but with your standard movie producer, who most people would never even be able to name, and even somebody who you would think would be a particularly low-level employee seems to know quite a few tricks to... so these were crabs, these little rocks, little eggs for white crabs. And they're going to turn into a giant ball. In a later Batman Lego game, you see a bunch of bats, and I bet a lot of the algorithm and programming to make these crabs do their actions is not too far off from what we just saw. I guess you're just supposed to dig this one up, and then by digging up this piece, the crabs will probably all pick it up too. There's a lot of dig spaces being pointed towards. I don't think this is ever really explained in the movie how any of this happens. It's just in the imagination of Jack Sparrow. Whereas this would make a lot of sense if there had just been an enchantment on the Black Pearl to make it live forever. Or if you straight up just said that Jack Sparrow tied his own essence to the ship, so the ship never dies until Jack dies, and Jack never dies until the ship dies, so they're forever intertwined, interconnected. That would explain a lot. So you pull up the... pull up the anchor, and now he's just trying to pull the ship on dry land. And these guys are gonna help him, I guess. It would even make sense if it was just these are crabs and they're magically intelligent, and they're happy that you that Jack Sparrow killed the Kraken, because the Kraken was eating a ton of crabs. That would be a fine explanation. Meanwhile, Well, these guys, I guess, fell off the edge of the world and ended up landing on the ship. Oh, and apparently the crabs were being controlled by the new voodoo lady. Which, seeing the crabs crawl up her under her dress is probably not the way you'd want to depict that in a Lego game. Like, it would make more sense for the crab to crawl up, like, on her shoulder and she'd kiss it like it's her pet, or crawl in her hair. Because you are just establishing that she may be a mystical creature, which that's fine, but I don't think that gets explained. Yeah, I'm in this very weird position because it's kind of impossible to criticize this game from the perspective of someone who either barely watched the movies or didn't watch the movies, whereas that is kind of the exact position a lot of kids would be in. And in all fairness, like, I've just not been in line with that position in any of the other Lego games. Like, when I'm playing Lego Star Wars, I've totally seen Lego Star Wars. When I'm playing Lego Indiana Jones, I've totally seen Indiana Jones movies. And seen them enough that I can generally remember almost all of it. If anything, this game highlights why you have to tread with extreme caution if you were going to make a Lego game based on a less recognizable movie license. The Batman games and the Marvel games, you know who the main characters are, even if they are giving you original stories, so it's not as big of an issue. Interesting, a ship in a bottle inside of a ship in a bottle. Once again, we are inside the bowels of the ship, and the only thing I could think that they maybe did here is twist the 3D model so it's more square and you're looking at it from a different angle. Usually in the past you would be seeing the windows on the background, and now they're on the side. But they feels still very repetitive, and not very video gamey. Then you jump down here and you're on the next floor. I don't know what you could really do to a Lego game to allow this level of repetition, unless you were just gonna make an MMO World of Warcraft type thing where there's a Lego universe, and they tried to do that. I think it was called Lego Universe, where it wasn't going to have, at least originally they said it wasn't gonna have single player story missions, and it was gonna be all about opening up a more Minecraft style gameplay where people just crafted levels and items and built things for the fun of it. If anything, it went too far in that direction originally, which it didn't have real goals or as much goals or desire or things to draw the player to continue playing. But also, Lego Worlds or Lego Universe, whatever it was called, just didn't really ever feel like it was really trying to market itself towards kids. And it is a dangerous thought potentially to try and make a World of Warcraft MMO for kids, because kids have the whole screen time issue, where lots of parents are now enforcing screen time and making sure that they aren't playing hundreds of hours a week of video games. So, it becomes very questionable how you could make a game that was that grindy. And I think just grindiness for grindiness' sake is never really a good idea anyways. So, yeah. The solution to this game is not to try and reinvent the wheel. It's to simply have better level designs, have at least three distinct floors to the ship that look drastically different, put more effort into it, paint them different colors of paint. Decorate them with different things. Like, there should be a galley here somewhere. There should be a brig somewhere. There should be crewman's quarters with hanging like hammocks to sleep in, and then there should be specific rooms. There was a game I played. What was the name of that game? I can't remember. It's a kind of insurance investigation murder mystery, or just mystery game. It's done in this very stylized black and white presentation. I want to say it was something like The Voyage of Dawn Treader, but that's a Narnia book. But yeah, that game, since I can't remember the name of it, had a much more thought out and better designed concept of each floor, and there was really only about three floors. They're doing the gimmick here of dropping water on the guy again. And while it was a relatively small ship, probably even smaller than the ship that we're on right now, they were able to put a lot of thought into it and really make it work. This is actually the same guy that they dropped water on before. Also, it's interesting that there's just this red brick there. And we have to go back up. Like, at a certain point, it's probably smart that there would be Lego elements left after everything is said and done. Otherwise, you run the risk of the entire floor looking like a regular game and not a Lego game. Did we see a place where we could shoot things? Shoot the cannon. Did we see a place where we could get a flaming thing? And notice here how, alright, finally we have a giant squid. This probably should have been the first place you started on, is the top of the ship, but they didn't want you to start at the top of the ship because you probably then wouldn't even think about going down to lower parts of the ship. Notice how they had to put something there to help you. So they are running to the left and to the right of the ship because they've got to get it to flip over. Because flipping over the ship is the magic solution towards getting them back in the real world. In this oddly unestablished fake world. I have no idea what you're supposed to do there. It doesn't have... Like, you have this hook. But... There's no place to light anything. And fire the cannon. So it just feels like it's a Lego element that serves no purpose. I wish I could remember the name of that game, because that game also serves as just like a great example of the wild variety of monsters you could create and use for a sea story. Because it's, it's kind of a spoil to talk about any of it, but suffice it to say, there's quite a lot of different variety in monsters, and it all kind of makes sense because it implies the idea that sea creatures themselves are somewhat warlike and have other sea monsters that would work with each other or for each other. I guess you just have to hit that multiple times. And I appreciate the idea of tilting things left and right, because that does let this game then be more varied. Otherwise, you run the risk of this being the third time we've just been on this same ship. Alright, so in free play, we'll have to get that. Which that's pretty much where the other ship in the bottle was, so they're just kind of repeating themselves. And I tricked the wrong guy, and really had no indication that that would have been the wrong guy. Which, that kind of stinks, certainly, to make it fairly far, and then all of a sudden realize that you just guessed wrong. So they're trying to break the cannon free so it rotates also. Looking at these blue studs, it feels like you're trying to tilt the ship to get the blue studs and to flip it over. And then I guess you do enough of that. And it definitely feels like that should have been something that was hinted at in like the first movie, or hinted at way heavier in the rest of the movie. One assumes that it just had to be upside down when the sun set, otherwise you would fail miserably. And it seems like she could have used her little crabs to help flip the ship over. But yeah, you have this whole magical map that is telling you where to go. And or in this case, I might be telling you backstory that he was in love with her. And then he turned into the bad guy. They came out with a Pirates of the Caribbean pinball table relatively recently. This is a lot of pictures, and I am not really following this story. But I guess apparently she's the bad guy, and they didn't just realize that. The Pirates of the Caribbean pinball table is particularly interesting. It's got a lot going for it. It's really late to the party, though. And pinball table licenses, I think, are gonna just traditionally always be fairly late to the party. But there was also some elements like this spinning map that, in its original version, was way more popular, but for one reason or another didn't really work, so they took a lot of the functionality out of it. One of the problems with real-world Lego, real-world pinball tables, I haven't ever seen a Lego pinball table that would be available for sale. But while they are kind of having a slight resurgence in making pinball tables after the pinball being practically dead, they are incredibly behind the times and slow to program the actual pinball tables to work. So you're buying this device that has a very low chance of feeling like a complete product. It's just, and there's a chance, not a guaranteed chance, but there's a chance that if the table itself is just not a high seller or not really very profitable, that Stern in particular will kind of abandon it, or any of the pinball manufacturers, and you'll never have code that feels complete. On top of that problem, you have with real world pinball tables a lot of breakable mechanical items and a lot of maintenance and upkeep needed, where it really only makes sense for pinball tables to exist is if they are inside arcades, and it barely makes sense for arcades to exist. Because they're nowhere as profitable or well visited compared to arcades in the past. Okay. What can we do here? We're at 16 studs. We have orange crabs instead of white crabs. It lets us build this. So you build this, it gives you some studs. And then what? Then you break it, and it gives you some more studs. Try and get as many of the blue studs as possible. Treasure magnet for 225,000 studs. That's kind of expensive, but I think you probably just buy it now anyways. Just turn it on. Now with treasure magnet turned on, we can walk a lot closer to things to multiply studs. But I suppose that probably means you won't have much of anything else to really focus on. It's weird that this gate constantly is closed. We would need a lot there. We definitely aren't at a point where we would want to start buying people. We still have to play the game and break things. And we definitely are running the risk where you're going to spend way too much time running around after each level to try and get a nice collection of studs. With the blunderbuss cannon here, you can set up the environment, but you see that the studs disappear fairly quickly and people are getting in the way, so it's not like you're guaranteed that you'll actually walk. Which one is this? Character treasure? Sure. We'll turn that. We'll purchase that also. Now when we blow up people, we'll get treasures. But trying to blow up people is hardly gonna be easy. There's weirdness, there's like a red hat when I was walking around here that kind of appeared. This guy's too short to get up there. Yeah, the character treasures are not really dropping enough treasures for it to be worthwhile. Fall rescue, we don't have enough studs for. So we can't just buy everything. Yeah. We're feeling some kind of frame rate issues happen here with a lot of studs being destroyed and appearing. How many do we need here? 24? Yeah. Not quite there yet. With the stud magnet though, you can just kind of walk past these. You don't have to blow the door open. And if you are struggling to blow something up, you should probably just avoid it and move on. Extra toggle. Don't think that's something we want to get. Still haven't really figured out where that element is. I have to just assume it's somewhere here. Then a little bit of a hitch there. Another hitch there. Like, we're approaching what feels like micro-stuttering. But it's only in the hub world. Which is very different from micro-stuttering that was happening in the previous games. And it seems all too understandable as to why you would run into hitching in this game, because It obviously is a little underpolished as far as the engine. And the engines, in general, for LEGO games, needed a full reboot. See, that pause there makes a little less sense, but it almost certainly is all the crabs and fish and people spawning in and out. So, yeah, is there anything else to really look for here? Let's see. Yeah, this is getting pretty bad. Maybe this is a point where we exit out of things, or maybe this is... Maybe there's a point here where... Because... You have... The extras turned on. That's the thing that makes the... the game start stuttering. That would be weird if that's the case, but maybe. I'm trying to figure out if there's a shovel character. He has a pistol. He has his eye, which really doesn't get used to anything. He has a sword. Yeah. As far as like default characters with a shovel, that doesn't seem to exist. So where is the shovel? Because I'm fairly certain I've seen it somewhere around here. Yeah, I suppose this character we're playing as is supposed to be the Dread Pirate LeChuck equivalent to the Monkey Island games. Let's see. So you chase this guy around until he gets tired, and then he lets you run right on him. I can't afford that one. Where's the shovel? I guess I have to find the shovel. Yeah. I guess I didn't need to find the shovel, come to think of it though. Because I could have just used the dog. Which I've forgotten the dog even exists as a character. Alright, back to Marty. With his explosive guns. There's another kind of awkward camera angle going up the skirt of the, or going up the dress of the V voodoo lady, which they really didn't think about that from the scene, from the looks of it. Breathe underwater for 250,000. I don't know if it's really worth being able to breathe underwater at the moment. Like, it'll be a nice thing later, but we would kind of like to. Kind of like to do some other things first. Come on. Extra hearts for 500,000. That's not really worth getting either. Still in a weird position. And notice how that micro stuttering, the hitching kind of disappeared once we stopped blowing things up so much, once we just let everything kind of despawn. Yeah, it definitely seems to me like until we get to 24 gold bricks, we're not going to be able to come over here properly and open this door and see whatever is in here, as far as another area. And obviously we're not going to be able to get everything done until we have a lot more characters unlocked. So it just kind of feels like we are nowhere close towards unlocking the next thing, and so we're gonna probably have to just go through a couple of levels. We are now at 27.8% unlocked, and we have fast forge, character treasures, which is not really that useful, treasure magnet. Character treasure would be about the one I would regret the most. Always double is obviously good, treasure times two is obviously good. But it does definitely feel like we are just going to have to kind of grind through the main story going forward. And we're not going to really have anything extra to do other than maybe we just run around to get a little bit of studs. But probably a lot less than what we have been doing. The thing that is really killing me at the current moment is that either we never find another score multiplier, or we get to 1.5 million to get the score times 6 or 10 or whatever that one score multiplier that we have found is, as far as a red hat. Or we just wait until we get enough gold bricks, which is probably going to be 4 or 5 levels before we have 24 gold bricks. And then some of the open world hub stuff clearly won't be accessible until you have nearly all the gold bricks available to you, if not all the gold bricks available to you, which means we'll be deep into playing in free play mode, which probably does line up the idea that we are only 27.8% done. This game is potentially on the verge of getting a little grindy and a little long, even as a very short Lego game, in that it just doesn't really have movies that are keeping my attention compared to playing even like Lego Indiana Jones, which had some pretty bad levels, but the stories of Indiana Jones kept my attention. Here, I think the levels are kind of bad and the stories are kind of bad. So yeah, this could get a little grindy. So we should just end it here and move as fast as we can. As always, I ask you to like, share, subscribe, comment, and watch every second of my videos. If you want to friend or follow me on any social media sites, there's a whole bunch of links down below. And if you want to support me further, there's a link to Patreon. or you can friend me on Steam and gift me a game off my wish list. Thank you for watching. Have a good evening.